Yeah, Pastor Brian, so glad you joined us today for worship, and we have a special time together to call on God, and to pray, and to worship. We're going to have communion together, so a full day of great things, drawing closer to God. So Father, we just invite you, as we draw close to you, hear our prayer, hear our hearts, as we call upon you, in Jesus' name. Amen.
As you can see, we're missing a guitar player. He and his lovely wife are vacationing in, I'm going to say Alpena, but they Airbnb, whatever that means. They're up on a lake with a big picture window, and they're fishing. He carries fishing every day, and they have a boat, and they're playing and having a good vacation. So although we're perfect with him here, he won't be able to cover our imperfections. So overlook them with us and send through them. Remembering that after this, at the end of the service, we're going to have communion, and so all service long, you can be ready in your heart and talking to the Lord. Let the Spirit speak to you today.
Things. Most importantly for our souls, he conquered the grave and took upon our sins upon himself. And it makes him who he is, the great and awesome God, wonderful Savior. And this song is called "It Is You." Just speaks to that all the more.
Thank you. We ready to take the word for us. We're going to follow Jesus.
Together, greet one another. Take up your cross and follow. Good morning. You may be seated. I'm Pastor Brian. So glad you chose to worship with us today. What a great day. What a great day to gather together. Tithes and offerings, there's a box on the back wall. You can make a donation there. And if you notice in the bulletin, we are taking another drop off the wall. So we're down to $24,000. Just over $24,000. $30,000 match that the church is doing on top of that, so it's amazing as well. Sunday School for All Ages on Sunday morning at 9:30, Monday night pickleball at 6, Wednesday night the kids and the youth group are meeting at 6 from 6 to 8 for a summer bash activity thing here at the church. If you got kids or have grandkids, bring them, be a part of that from 6 to 8 on Wednesday night. Next Sunday after church, we're doing Olympics. We did it last year. It was a lot of fun. We need volunteers for timers and scores and stuff like that. So if you don't want to participate, at least sign up for that. It's like an outdoor potluck. It's the easiest way to describe it. So bring a dish to pass. Sign up on the bulletin board. Bring a dish to pass. And we'll provide the meat as well. And have some fun out in the backyard, watching the kids and having a great time. So if you don't feel like you want to participate, you know, be a timer or a judge or a volunteer or help out, cook hot dogs or whatever needs to be done. So please sign up so we can make sure we got enough food for everybody as well. We talked about this a couple weeks ago. This is my friend Jeff. Does everybody know Jeff? This is my friend Jeff. Jeff, how long have you been coming to this church?
We've been about 2 years, a little over 2 years.
About 2 years, yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I asked Jeff, you know, we talked about sharing our story. Last week we heard the ones that were being baptized, and I have certificates for those as well. But I want to start a new process in church where different people tell their story. So, Jeff, what's your story?
Well, for those that don't know me, I'm Jeff Warrens. I confessed Jesus as my Savior when I was 13 years old. And before that, when I was very young, my parents took us to Sunday school, you know, when I was really little. And then when I was probably in first or second grade, for whatever reason, we stopped. I'm the youngest of three kids, and I'm not sure what all drove us not doing that anymore, but we didn't for quite a while. My parents, they were very moral, upstanding people. And most people were, when I grew up at that time and where I grew up, most people had a respect for Christianity. They believed in God. They believed the Bible was true, and for the most part, even if they didn't necessarily practice and consider themselves a Christian. And I think the seeds were planted in those early years, though, when I was going to Sunday school for faith. And I had a desire to please God, even though we didn't participate in a church. And I did what I thought you were supposed to do. You know, I prayed every night at bedtime. You know, the prayers that you learn as a little kid, you know, I prayed them, and I thought you had to say them right. If you messed up the word, you had to start over, you know, those kind of things. So I did that, you know, and I tried to be a good person, you know, and so that's what I knew how to do. So later, a local pastor, was visiting homes, and he visited our house and got to know my parents, invited us to church, and we started attending a small Baptist church near where we live. And by then I'm, I think, about seventh or eighth grade. And as I was a little older than the previous times when I went to church, I started hearing some things that I didn't know, didn't understand, hadn't heard before. And one thing I remember is my parents talking with each other at home about that they didn't think they could, didn't know whether they could be good enough to be Christians. Hmm. And as I said, they were very moral, upstanding people. And I didn't understand that really. I didn't know what they were talking about. But a few weeks went by, I think it was maybe a little longer, but some time went by, and they told us, as kids, they let us know that they had gotten saved, that they were Christians now. And at that time, I was really didn't know what getting saved meant. Didn't even know what that was. So I was learning things, you know, so I found out that, like I said, I thought I was a Christian by praying, by doing those prayers, by being good, you know. But as I found out, we all need a Savior. We're all lost and without Him. So once I found that out, once I learned about that, I wanted that salvation too. So it wasn't long later that I came on a Sunday night, knelt at an altar similar to this, and confessed Jesus as my Savior, as the Lord in my life. So he became my Savior. And, you know, that's just the beginning, of course. You know, that I'm 13 years old, and it's been quite a few years since then. And, you know, Brian asked the one thing to share was what difference has Christ made in our lives, you know, in my life. And the only way I could answer that is every way.
Amen.
In every way. You know, not that I've done things right all the time, and it's taken a lot of time to grow in those years. But God equipped, you know, God's the Most High God, and He's the Lord, and He can make us do right. He can make us do His will, but He doesn't. He calls us to do it. He invites us to do it, and He equips us to do it if we accept those things. And you know, the three main ways. You know, when we receive Him as our Lord, His Holy Spirit dwells in us, empowers us, and guides us on how to do that, how to hear. But we have to pay attention. You know, that's the thing. We have to choose to listen. God doesn't force us. And then also, it tells us that we need to pray. Pray. Not because He doesn't know what we need, but because He wants us to be connected to Him and for us to understand that He's the source for the things that we need, and to pray and to show us things through prayer. Sometimes He teaches us things through prayer. Yeah, and then the other main thing is the Word of God. You know, the inspired Word of God is what we have to guide us and instruct us and equip us. You know, 2 Timothy chapter 3, it tells us that very thing. All the Scripture is, in different translations, one of them says it's God-breathed.
Yeah.
And it's useful for correction, for instruction, for rebuke, for training us and equipping us as His servants. And again, we have to choose to study it, to learn it, to understand what's in the Word of God. There's a lot there, and it's the whole Word of God, the Old Testament, the New Testament. There's a lot that I'm learning now, even after all these years, in the last few years, a lot more that I'm learning about how, what script, some of the scriptures mean that maybe I've read many times and thought I got it, thought I understood it, but there's a lot of deeper meaning if you dig. And you know, the Bible's like that. It's simple. The message is simple enough for most anyone to get it. But the more you study, the more you learn, the deeper you see it goes. And the more it's connected. Things from Genesis through Revelation, you know, that you might not realize at first, why does it say this? Why did Christ say this? Why did one of the writers in the New Testament refer to something? Doesn't really make sense. I don't know what that means. But you find that it refers to something in the prophets or in, you know, from that Moses wrote about. And, you know, it's like the message, God knows the end from the beginning. And he created it, and he gave this message all along that goes from the end to the from the beginning to the end. And he's given us all these words to guide us. But we have to dig in there and let him teach us that way. So
do you have a favorite scripture?
Well, I would say, you know, I really didn't think I had a favorite. There's so many you could pick, but I'm gonna stick with that one in 2 Timothy chapter 3, it's 15-17, and mm-hmm. He starts off as he's instructing Timothy. He's had these holy scriptures, and that's what guides him. And they're inspired by God, the whole word. You know, as we see our society rejecting God's word in most ways. And even churches, even Christian churches are turning from God's word, and it's important that we embrace it and we dig in there. And that's the whole key to equip us to serve the Lord.
Thank you, Jeff. Thanks for sharing.
Appreciate it. Jeff.
Let's do our Bible verse together, and the kids can be dismissed for junior church. And I do have certificates for all the ones getting baptized. Let's do our verse together.
When God saw what he did, he did not return from their evil ways. He cleansed it, and did not bring on them the destruction he had threatened. Jonah 3:2.
Thank you.
It's funny, that song, singing that song, I don't know how many of you related that to exactly what Jeff just talked about. That God is the one. And he's from beginning to end.
Yep.
And he is who he is. And we can trust him to lead us, to guide us, and help us to learn from him, because he is who he is.
You are my all and all. Sweet and precious, true. Are to be loved, I'd be a fool. You
stand together for prayer. Father, we come to realize that you are God. You are amazing, mighty to save, full of grace and compassion, loving kindness. And we get to choose whether we accept your love or run from your love. We get to choose whether we invite you in to affect every part of our lives, or whether we keep you out. I pray, Father, that we would choose you today. Father, I pray for those that are going through physical issues of life. I pray for Rich's daughter, Rachel, who's in the hospital in ICU and going through a troubled time. I pray that you come around the family, the doctors, give them wisdom. Let your presence fill the room. Father, we pray for others that have been injured this week and hurting and facing rehab and surgeries and procedures and all kinds of things. Father, we pray for the young man in our community who's no longer with us. Father, there's hurting people all around us. And Father, sometimes we just lose sight of what the important things are of life. We get distracted by the shiny things of life, the comfortable things. And I pray that, Father, today you remind us there's a lost and hurting world all around us. And we have the best news. We have the only news of hope. So, Father, I pray that we would tell our story. It would make a difference in someone's life. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. The children are already gone. They're gone. If you haven't gone. My public service announcement is get out and vote. Vote your conscience. Vote what the Word of God says. Vote your heart. Get out and vote. And let God guide you. Do the homework, the research, and be aware what's going on. A disciple of Jesus is a
learner.
Learning to
love like Jesus, walk like Jesus, live like Jesus, to be like Jesus to others.
My prayer is that the Holy Spirit would help us be more like Jesus today. From the Word of God, it would teach us. And we take it in and apply it to our lives and make a difference. We started the series of Jonah with the question, are you like Jonah? And I had a whole list of things, and I think we're a lot like Jonah. And even today, we're going to be even more like Jonah, I hope, like Jonah. As Jeff said, the Old Testament connects to the New Testament. Jonah is one of those Bible verses that we look at the book of Jonah. We know the story, the big fish, all that kind of stuff. But Jesus refers to Jonah also in Matthew. And I think there's about three places in the New Testament it refers to Jonah. So it confirms what was going on as well. And one of the challenges from last week, we talked about prayers. Did you have a time of prayer with just tears? Just praying and asking God from our tears, calling out to Him. Let's do a quick recap. Jonah, he gets the message of the word of the Lord. Lord says, go to Nineveh, preach against the people. Jonah says, no, I'm going the other way. Runs the opposite direction, buys a ticket, jumps on a boat, gets out into the ocean. Big storm comes along. They cast lots. They fall on Jonah. Jonah says, it's my fault. I disobeyed God. I'm running from God. What should we do? Pick me up, throw me overboard. They pick him up, throw him overboard. And Jonah's swallowed by a big fish. And for the next 3 days and three nights, he's covered with seaweed and the smell of fish, and that becomes his prayer closet. And he prays out to God and says, God, chapter 2, verse 10, 9 and 10. But I shout with grateful praise was sacrificed to you. What I vowed, I will make good. I will say, salvation comes from the Lord. Then the Lord commanded the fish to vomit him up on shore. So Jonah gets a second chance, is really what it boils down to. It's the easiest way to think about it. Jonah gets a second chance. Have you ever had a second chance? Ever blown it and got a second chance? Yeah. And a third, and a fourth, and a fifth, and have you ever had a second chance? God is the God of second chances. Isn't he?
Yes.
Just think, the first time you sin, what if God zapped you with lightning? How many would be here? None of us. All right. We had a second chance, and a third chance, and a fourth chance. Over and over again, God comes along with his love and his compassion and reaches out to us. Why does he do that? Because he loves us. Because he has compassion. Because he has something for you to do that's incredible. But often we just don't do that. Sometimes we're going to say, well, how come God sends people to hell? Well, God doesn't send people to hell. People choose, right? People choose not to obey God. People choose to turn their back on God. Just like Jonah, he turned and ran the other way. People choose to walk away from God, from his love and his grace and his mercy. They choose to disobey him. But Jonah gets a second chance. Look at with me, Jonah chapter 3 and 4. I'm going to cover two chapters today, and it won't be that long because they're short little chapters. Jonah chapter 3, verse 1. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. This is after he's been spit up, vomited up on shore, seaweed around his head. The word of the Lord comes to him and says, go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim the message I give you. Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord and went to Nineveh. Now Nineveh was a very large city. It took 3 days to walk through it. Jonah began going on his day's journey into the city proclaiming, 40 days, here's the message, 40 days from now Nineveh is going to be overthrown. Nineveh is going to be destroyed. It's just the opposite of what Jonah did the first time. Instead of running from it, Jonah goes to the city of Nineveh, starts proclaiming the message, 40 days, if you don't repent of your sin, you don't turn to God, if you don't, the whole city is going to be destroyed. Verse 5, the Ninevites believed God. A fast was proclaimed, and all of them, from the greatest to the least, they put on sackcloth. That was a sign of mourning. If you want to get something done, I would suggest you start with prayer and fasting. You're facing a big decision? Prayer and fasting. You don't know what to do? Prayer and fasting. Your trouble with your relationships, trouble at work, trouble going on, wherever you're at, prayer and fasting. That should be our first step that we go to. It's prayer, time with God, calling out in desperation, if necessary, use words, just your tears, whatever, and fasting, denying yourself from the pleasures of things around us to focus in on God. So prayer and fasting, verse 6. When Jonah, warning, reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, took off his royal robe, covered himself in sackcloth, and sat down in the dust. This is the proclamation that he issued to all the Ninevites. But the decree from the king is this to the nobles. Do not let any people or animal, I don't know how you keep animals from eating them other than not feeding them. Do not let people, herds, flocks, taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink. But let the people and the animals be covered with sackcloth. Let everyone call urgently on God. Let them give up their evil ways and their violence. Turn from their sins. Give it up. Walk away from it. Verse 9. Who knows? It's a question. God may relent. God might not bring destruction and have compassion on us and turn his fierce anger so we will not be punished. When God saw what they did, God responded. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring destruction that he threatened on them. God reconsidered his plan. His plan was this wicked city, I'm going to eliminate it, just like Sodom and Gomorrah. I'm going to eliminate the whole city. If they don't repent, I'm going to just eliminate all of them. They're going to be wiped off. Animals, cattle, 120,000 people, just going to be wiped away. But then God saw their prayer, heard their prayers, saw their fasting, saw them mourning, wearing sackcloth, sitting in the dust. God reconsidered the urgency of their prayer. Saw it. This wasn't just a quick, hey God, I'm sorry, get me through this problem and then I'm going to go back to my old ways. This wasn't just, hey, I hope we can fool God. No, this is serious stuff. This is when you get really serious about what you're doing. This is when you come honest face to face with God and you're serious about it and you say, hey, I got to do this. This is a life or death, heaven or hell situation. I got to make a change. I got to do something. So the whole city was affected by Jonah's testimony. The whole city, everyone in it. I wonder how many people are affected by your story. I wonder. We don't know. Oftentimes we don't understand it. Just the other day someone says, hey, that guy that shared Easter morning, what was his name? I said, Brandon. I said, he said, man, his story was powerful. 6 months, 5 months later, he's still remembering what Brandon said before prayer time. I hope the words that Jeff shared will ring in your hearts and lives and say, man, you know what? I kind of was like that too. I just thought I was a good person and that's all I needed to do. No, I needed more. I needed Jesus in my heart. I needed to study the Word of God. I needed to learn. 1 Peter 3 says it like this. Always be ready to give an answer, to share your story. The three that shared their stories last week, and they shared them with tears. Elena crying. It's like perfect, like just with tears, sharing her heart. What's your story? Who have you shared your story with? When was the last time you shared your story? Sharing your story. Jonah chapter 4. The whole city repents because of Jonah's testimony. Going through the city. Repent. Turn from your sins. The message from God. Turn from your evil ways. Verse 1, chapter 4. This changed their plan greatly. The plans changed greatly, and Jonah was upset. He became very angry. He complained to the Lord. How many people ever complained to the Lord? Come on, be honest. It's okay. God, you don't ask my prayer the way I think you should, right? I'm going to help you. How's that work for you? He became very angry, and he complained to the Lord, and here's what he says. Didn't I say before I left home, way back there, that you would do this, Lord? This is why I ran to Tarsus. Jonah's trying to justify why he did not go to Nineveh to begin with, because he knew that God was loving and compassionate, and he's not going to follow through, and he's going to save all those people. Why bother? Isn't it the same thing we do? My coworker isn't a Christian, but I'm sure God's going to send someone in to talk to him. Why should I bother to say anything? My teammates really aren't Christians. They don't even know about Jesus. But, you know, I'm not going to say anything. Someone else can do it. Why should I bother? Jonah, why should I? Why should I go all the way over there if you're just going to give up anyways? Jonah must have forgotten how much grace and mercy God showed on him, right? Wasn't he just in the belly of the well for 3 days? And now 120,000 people's lives are changed, transformed, going to heaven. And he forgot that he was drowning, swallowed by a big fish. He forgot God's mercy on his own life. Isn't that us too? We see the speck in the other person. Oh, look what they did. Look what they did. Look what they did. And we never go, look what I did. Look what I did. Look how I did this. Oh, man. Jonah got angry with God. He got mad because of what happened. He forgot about his own sin. And we do that too. We forget about our own sin. How many times has God forgiven us? How many times has he given us a second chance and a third chance? How many times? And we look at someone else and we pick out some little... Oh. Jonah complains. He becomes angry with God. Because God spared 120,000 people. I knew you were merciful and compassionate, slow to anger, full of your unfailing love. You have urged them to turn back from destroying the people. So here's Jonah's response. Just kill me now. Verse 3. Just kill me now, Lord. I'd rather be dead than to live than be alive if what I predicted did not come true. did not happen. Since God did destroy the 120,000 people, since the whole city of Nineveh wasn't destroyed, Jonah's words, prophecy, he was a prophet, so his words didn't come true. So Jonah's like, I got egg on my face. I told everybody they're going to die. I told everybody that God's going to do it. And God doesn't do it, so I look like a false prophet. God, you made me look foolish because I went through and did exactly what you told me to do. And everybody's life got changed and transformed, and now I look stupid because I did what God called me to do. You might as well just kill me, God, and be done. That's where Jonah's at. I'd rather be dead, he says. I wonder how often we worry about who gets the glory, God or me. Because that's really what Jonah's worried about. Because Jonah's got egg on his face because what he said was going to happen didn't happen because God changed his mind and had compassion and showed love and grace and mercy. And Jonah looked foolish. But God got the glory. 120,000 lives transformed, born again, heading for heaven. And the Lord cried, do you have a right to be angry about this? Verse 4. So my question is, what do you get angry about? What do you get angry about? What do you get mad about? Everybody think of one thing. Last week you got angry about one thing. Just one. Everybody got something? Here you go. Did you get angry about the war going on in Israel, Ukraine? Or did you get angry about your kids not cleaning their room? Did you get angry about the human trafficking that's going on in our country? Or did you get mad because the cops pulled you over because you were speeding? What do you get angry about? Did you get angry about the abortion and the unborn babies that are taking place? Or have you got angry at your spouse because dinner wasn't ready or something happened? What did you get angry about? Did you get angry at the sin and brokenness in our community? Or did you get angry about your car not starting? Or it was too hot when I got into it? Because I left the windows on. See, what do you get angry about? Jonah got angry because 120,000 people's lives just got saved. And the cattle and everything was saved. He's got angry. What do you get angry about? So Jonah goes off to the west side, verse 5, chapter 4. Then Jonah went out to the east side of the city and made a little shelter and sat down under it and waited to see what the Lord was, what was going to happen to the city, because he still has, you know, he hears God said, I'm going to save him, but he's wondering, you know, is he really going to destroy him? Is he going to save him? So he goes out to sit down and watch the show, what's going to happen. He knows that God's going to do it. Verse 6. And the Lord arranged a leafy plant to grow up there. And soon it spread its broad leaves over Jonah's head and shaded him from the sun. This eased his discomfort. And Jonah was very grateful for the plant. So Jonah has a plant giving him shade. His discomfort's gone. He is tickled pink. He's got a plant over his head. Right? Isn't that what the scripture says? Yeah, I'm not misquoting it. It's right there, right? Verse 6. Jonah's anger is replaced by the joy of a plant. Let that soak in for a minute. Because a plant grew up and gave him shade, his anger, and he has joy because he has a plant over his head. I wonder how many times we're just like Jonah. I mean, come on. When our anger is, or our discomfort is pleased by the other things. When our discomfort goes from me to something else, and it brings me a little joy. Let me go to Medlin just for a moment, okay? Hang on. Let's call this our shiny things of life that brings us comfort, okay?
Squirrel, yeah.
Let's think about that. Let's call them the shiny things of life. It's like when we get a new car. We get a new car, we're all excited. Wow, I got a new car. And it's like we have new joy because we have this brand new car. This is before we get the payment book, though. We have this great joy. We got this new car, right? Or we get a new job, or we get a raise, or we get a new house, or we get a new ring, or a new gun, or a new outfit. We get something new, and we get all excited, and we got joy because, my discomfort's gone away. I got something else to focus on. I got something to bring me a little bit of happiness, and I have this moment of happiness. That's where Jonah's at. I got a little bit of happiness. All's good. I got happiness. A little bit of happiness just for a moment. And then, verse 7, the Lord arranged a worm the next day at dawn. The worm ate through the stem of the plant and it withered away. The shiny thing became dead. The distraction that Jonah was so excited about is now gone. Jonah's mission, remember Jonah's mission? What was Jonah's mission? Go to Nineveh and proclaim the gospel, right? That's his mission. That was his mission. Go to Nineveh, proclaim the gospel. He gets distracted by the shiny thing that brings him a little bit of joy. God sends a worm along, eats the plant, it dies, and now Jonah's frustrated. He's distracted. He's mad because the plant's dead now. Same thing happens with us. We're just like Jonah. When the new car gets a dent in it, when we lose that wedding ring or whatever we wanted, it's gone. When our new outfit ends up with a stain on it, when the plant died, Jonah, can't believe it. We get distracted. We get distracted what the real important things are in life. When the shiny things have let us down, we lose sight of what God's doing, what God has called us to do. And we're so focused on the shiny things of life, the little bit of shade that we got. And then God sends a scorching heat. I think this is just icing on the cake. The sun beat down on his head until he grew faint. He was like wishing to die. Death would be certainly better. He explained. I wonder how often we feel like that. I just want to give up. Don't give up. Jonah felt that way because he took his eyes off of God and he looked at the shiny things of life, the things that brought pleasure to him of life, and it disappointed him because it died, and so now he wants to give up. And we do the same thing. My marriage is a mess. It's falling apart. I must give up. Don't. Take your eyes off the shiny things and put them back on the cross. Put them back on Jesus. Take your eyes off of this stuff and put them back, because he's bigger than our problems. Verse 9, then God said to Jonah, is it right for you to be angry because the plant died? Yes, Jonah retorted, even angry enough to die. Then the Lord said to him, you feel sorry about a plant. Though you did nothing to put it there, it came up quickly, then died. But the city of Nineveh, with 120,000 people, lives in spiritual darkness, not to mention all the animals, shouldn't you feel sorry for that great city? Jonah was more concerned about a plant than 120,000 people. Jonah got angry because plant died. than care about the people. We cry when our car gets in an accident. We cry when our pet dies. We cry when we lose something. We cry. When was the last time you cried over someone who's lost? When was the last time you just shed tears for someone that you knew that was lost? Didn't know Jesus. A classmate, a teammate, a coworker, a neighbor, a friend, a family member. When was the last time you cried over that? Over the brokenness in our world? Jonah got mad because the plant died. But the 120,000 lives that were spared, seems like you've been thrown a party. What are the shiny things of our life that we have been so focused on and spent so much time on and not seeing the lost people around us? Are you really concerned about the lost people that live in our community? See, the way I read the Bible, it says that Jesus came to seek and save those who were lost. Jesus cared about the lost. And if Jesus cared about that, I want to be like Jesus, right? A disciple of Jesus wants to be like Jesus. Shouldn't lost people matter to us? Let's take a test. I'm almost done. Let's take a test real quick. Ready? How much time did you spend praying for the lost this last week versus how much time you spent shopping? How much time did you spend working on your yard versus praying for the lost this week? How much time did you play games this week versus praying for the lost? See, what's important to us, we spend our time, energy, and resources on, because that's where our heart is. That's our priority. Is the lost really your priority? We're going to have communion. Let me explain it to you this way. Before you have communion today, if you have a bulletin, I hope you do. If not, just grab a piece of paper. Would you write down five people that you're going to start praying for the opportunity and the privilege to share your story of what God is doing in your heart and life? Just write down a couple names for me, right? Who are those people on your team, your classmates, people in your school, people in your neighborhood, your family, your friends? Who are those people that you can begin to pray for, to break the ground, open the soil for the word of God, the seeds to go into their hearts and make a difference? Jonah lost sight of the 120,000 people. And he got concerned about the plant that died. He got mad at God. What Jonah forgot was that he was redeemed. Jonah forgot that he was saved by a big fish, by God giving him a second chance. And if you've been given a second chance and you have been redeemed, saved, ask Jesus into your heart. I invite you to have communion with us. But let's not lose sight of those people around us that are hurting, lost, need to hear the love of Jesus. Randy's going to come and play a song as we distribute communion today to you. But I want you to write down some names. And as we're listening to the song and waiting, we'll take communion together. Will you start to pray for those people that God would give you that opportunity to plant that seed? If necessary, use words. To share the good news of Jesus, what he's done in your heart and life. Because he's redeemed you. Share it with them. Same person I used to be. I'm redeemed. Jesus took the bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples. He said, "This is my body, bruised and broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me and be thankful." In like manner, after supper, he took the cup and he gave it to his disciples. He said, this is my blood of the new covenant. It's the blood that was shed for you and for me, so we can be forgiven. So we don't have to be the man I used to be. Take and drink and be thankful. Father, we are grateful, thankful, overwhelmed, humbled, that we don't have to be who we used to be, that we can be redeemed. And Father, because of that, help us to tell our stories that others might be redeemed also. Help us not to get distracted by the shiny things of life that are here today and gone tomorrow. Help us to keep our eyes fixed on you. Father, help us. Help us to pray, fast, call upon you to those people that live around us, those people that we're elbows with, people we see at the store, at work, at home, at school, that we can share our story, the amazing story of being redeemed and set free from our sins. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. There's baskets on the sides. If you'd help us with the cups, that would be greatly appreciated. Next Sunday is the Olympics and potluck. Please sign up for that so we make sure we got food for everyone. And thanks for being with us and worshiping. Go tell your story of what God has done in your heart and life.